మనము ఆత్మ సాక్షాత్కారాన్ని పొందడానికి భగవత్ సారూప్యాన్ని, సామీప్యాన్ని, సాలోక్యాన్ని, సాయుజ్యాన్ని పొందడానికి ఏవేవి విషయాలు మనకు అడ్డు వస్తున్నాయి, వాటిని ఏ విధముగా మనము తొలగించుకొని కైవల్య ప్రాప్తి పొందవచ్చు అనే విషయాలను ఇప్పుడు చూద్దాం.
ఇంద్రియాణి పరాణ్యాహు ఇంద్రియేభ్యః పరం మనః మనసస్తు పరా బుద్ధిః యో బుద్ధేహి పరతస్తు సః.
నౌ లెట్ అస్ లుక్ ఎట్ ద స్కీమాటిక్ రిప్రజెంటేషన్ ఆఫ్ ద సెల్ఫ్ డిస్కవరీ. దిస్ ఇస్ బేస్డ్ ఆన్ ద శ్లోక జస్ట్ వీ హ్యావ్ సీన్ ఫ్రమ్ భగవద్గీత. లెట్ స్టార్ట్ ఫ్రమ్ ద బాటమ్ ఆఫ్ ద స్లైడ్. ద ఎక్స్టీరియర్ వరల్డ్, దిస్ ఎక్స్టీరియర్ వరల్డ్ ఈజ్ పెర్సీవ్డ్ బై అస్ విత్ ద హెల్ప్ ఆఫ్ ద ఫైవ్ సెన్స్ ఆర్గన్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ కాల్డ్ ద ఇంద్రియాస్. దీస్ ఇంద్రియాస్ ఛానల్ ద ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ ఇన్ టు ద బాడీ అండ్ త్రూ ద బాడీస్ కండక్టింగ్ సిస్టమ్ ది రీచ్ ద మైండ్. హియర్ వాట్ ఈస్ సెడ్ ఈజ్ ద ఇంద్రియాస్ ఆర్ ఎట్ అ హయ్యర్ ప్లేన్ than the exterior world and the mind is at a higher plane than the sense organs. This mind, after perceiving the information, will send output and instructions for the karma through the karmendriyas as a response to the input provided into the mind. If the mind is left on its own, it would always try and want to chase what is presented to it by the indriyas. So there is another level called the intellect, and this intellect or the buddhi is superior to the mind, and it exerts a control over the mind and sees that the mind doesn't go with what is presented to it per se. The intellect decides what is to be done and what not to be done, and that discriminative faculty is called the intellect or the buddhi. This is least developed in an infant or a toddler who does not know that a moving object is a snake and it will be injurious to him. So there is another level which we do not perceive normally, is this intellect, the mind, the body, the sense organs, the motor organs, all are under the superpower or the chaitanya of the individual, and that inner chaitanya or pratyek atman, indwelling Atman, is the Jeevatman or the inner spirit. What Bhagavad Gita slokam here demonstrates to us that this hierarchy has to be respected and followed. The indriyas or sense organs per se, they do not have good and bad. It is if they are acting under the influence of the mind, which is conditioned by the intellect, then the indriyas can see certain things which the intellect direct to see and the mind is allowed to see. Likewise, the karmendriyas will give the output or the motor activity required through the body as directed by the intellect, which is controlling the mind. So far we have understood this hierarchy. So let us move on to the next slide.
Indriyani paranyahuh ఇంద్రియేభ్యః పరం మనః మనసస్తు పరా బుద్ధిః యో బుద్ధేహి పరతస్తు సః.
కేర్ఫుల్లీ లెట్ అస్ ట్రై అండ్ అండర్స్టాండ్ దిస్ డయాగ్రమాటిక్ రిప్రజెంటేషన్. లెట్ అస్ స్టార్ట్ ఫ్రమ్ ద సెంటర్. వీ హ్యావ్ ద వైట్ సర్కిల్ విచ్ ఈజ్ ద పురుష, the Atman, the knower, the Kshetrajna, or we don't have a name for that. That's why it is called that. Thou art that. You are that. What is that? That is that. We don't know what is that. It is the Purusha, or the Atman, or the knower. Now, this Purusha is enveloped by several layers. The green circle there is the intellect. This intellect is a higher faculty than the mind, but this also is functioning under the chaitanya of the Atman or the Purusha. This intellect has to be developed in such a way that it realizes what is true and what is not true. This is called Nitya Anitya Vastu Vivechana, also called the Vivekam, the discriminative ability to hold on to what is permanent and real and negate all those which are impermanent, unreal and transient. To develop that faculty in the intellect is the whole sadhana. This intellect or the buddhi has got another companion functioning as a back office. That back office is called the chitta. Okay, the front office is the buddhi and the back office is the chittam. Chittam is the faculty of registration and recall in the mind, which resides in the frontal lobe of the brain. What does this do? This always tells the buddhi, based on its own experiences or experiences of others or shastra pramanas, what is written in the scriptures or the law of the land. Based on that knowledge, the chitta will always caution the buddhi and guide it and give reference to it to do what to be done and what not to be done and how to instruct the mind to go in a particular way. So now I understood that we have the Purusha as the inner core, and enveloping that is the buddhi, and along with that is the functioning inner office which is called the chitta. Now the red circle there is the mind. Mind is rajasic. Always it is a screen. Whatever you project onto it, it is shown. And mind always is wavering. Always is after things. Is always after pleasures. Is always after sense fulfillments, gratifications. It is the intellect or the buddhi along with the chitta which controls the mind and conditions the mind to work and go in a particular way. In an individual who has got the intellect very well developed and then the discriminative faculty is functioning at its best, the mind cannot take him away into wherever it wants. If we do not nurture our intellect, we will fall prey to what the mind says, and sometimes or many a time we will be in trouble. Along with this mind, there is a back office. That back office is called the ahankara. Ahankara means I am the doer, I am the enjoyer, this is being done by me, this is related to me, this is mine, the me and I concept. This concept is very dangerous because we always assume whatever is done in a perfect way is done by us and throw the blame on others at the slightest disappointment of what is not being done as you thought. This is the faculty of the ahankara. So the mind and the ahankara together try to influence in such a way that as though we are doing and we are the enjoyers of all the good things, and will try to take away us in a particular direction which the indriyas present to the mind. But if the buddhi and the chitta are well developed and well conditioned, they will restrain the mind, they will reduce the ahankara, the effect of the ahankara or the ego on the mind, and tell, my dear, everything is possible because of total effort of so many people. It is not only because of you. If that thought occurs, if that way of thinking is rooted firmly, then mind cannot waver and then take us away wherever it likes. And of course, now we see the black circle, that is the body. This body, as far as the philosophy is concerned, is inert or jada padartha. Unless there is chaitanya inside and the mind and the buddhi are working on that, the body cannot on its own do good or bad things. Okay, having said that, this body is very essential for the experiences that the mind will have under the influence of the buddhi. And this body is the gateway for all the inputs to go and the return pathway for all the outputs to come. Nurturing the body and keeping in perfect condition and health is essential for the development of mind and for the development of buddhi. Now, this body on its own cannot see the world. It is blind. It doesn't have any way of understanding what is happening outside. There are five gateways through which it observes. There are five windows through which it sees the world. These are the five jnanendriyas or the sensory organs or the input channels. If we have to perceive the world, one or more of the sensory input has to go into the mind. Otherwise, we cannot cognize the world. Once we cognize an object, it is registered in the mind and we recognize that when we see it next time. That is why it is called recognition. These sensory organs together with the body will take the inputs from the world and present it to the mind. It is for the mind to filter the information and then use what is required only and ask the buddhi whether this information is useful, acted upon in a particular way. It also gives the information to chitta to retain there whatever is required and to delete all the files which are not required. This is the process of registration and recall. Now, how does the indriyas influence the person? Indriyas per se are raga rahita. They don't have anything connected to good or bad. It is what the mind under the influence of the buddhi tells the indriyas to do. Only they will see, touch, smell, taste, hear those things. So how best we can control the necessary inputs? By regulating the gateways and allowing only those inputs which are essential and nurturing to the mind and filter all those at the doorstep. That is why these are called the gateways or the gates. Just as we have a door for our house to allow only people who have a bona fide purpose to come in, these indriyas should be conditioned and trained to allow only the bona fide information and filter everything else. Closing the indriyas is no use. If we close all the indriyas, close all the windows, how do we observe the external world? How do we perceive and experience the good things? So, negating the indriyas is no answer. Conditioning them and controlling them to filter the information and send required input only. This is called shamam, or the shama in Sanskrit is restraining the indriyas. Dama is restraining the mind in spite of receiving the inputs, in spite of receiving negative inputs. Shama and Dama. Now, the world outside is the Jagat. Jiva is the BMI, body, mind, intellect, and of course the soul. And W is the world outside, the Jagat. Jiva and the Jagat. Jiva is a part of the Jagat. Jiva and Jagat together are the creation of the Deva. Jiva, Deva, Jagat, interrelationship and interaction. So the Jiva are thou or you. In a larger sense, we. Thou art that. Tat, tvam, asi. You are that. Tvam, tat, asi. Tvam, thou, tat, that. Almost same pronunciation. Tvam, you, tat, that, asi, are. You are that. You are what? You are not the world, not the indriyas, not the body, not the mind, not the ahankara, not the buddhi, not the chitta, but you are that purusha, pratyek atma, or jivatma. The jivatma and the paramatma are the same. Qualitatively the same. Quantitatively they are different. Just like the drop of water in the wave in an ocean is the jiva, the whole ocean is the deva or the paramatma. Pratyagatma is the drop of water and paramatma is the whole ocean, mighty ocean. Qualitatively there is no difference. It is quantitatively only that different. The summation of all jivatmas, sigma jivatmas or sigma small n is equal to the capital N or the paramatma. This is the understanding that we have to have. The WBMI, world, body, mind, intellect together are called prakriti or field or matter. Or this is called the kshetram. Kshetra kshetrajna. The kshetram is the field or the matter, and this matter is understood only by the kshetrajna. Kshetrajna is the purusha. So this is the relationship of the jiva to the deva or the jivatma to the paramatma. Okay, let us move on to the next slide. This slide represents the hierarchy as per the Gita sloka. The body under the influence of the mind, mind under the control of the intellect, and all three, body, mind, intellect, are being overseen, are being illuminated, are being powered by the soul or the Chaitanya. So body, mind, intellect, also called BMIS complex, and this is the hierarchy.
Nigadyate antahkaranam mano dhirahankriti chittamiti svavrutivihi manasastu sankalpa vikalpanadibhir buddhihi padadhya vyavasaya dharmatah.
So let us look at the internal controllers or the antahkaranas. We have two offices functioning. There are four offices. Front office is managed by the mind and the intellect complex, and the back office is managed by the ego and the consciousness complex. Mano, buddhi, ahankara, chitta. Mano is mind, buddhi is intellect, ahankara is the ego, and chitta is the consciousness. Mind considers the sensory inputs, special sensory inputs, and deciphers them into pros and cons and submits to the buddhi. Buddhi is the discriminative faculty. It discriminates the actions to be taken and actions not to be taken for the input. The ego and the consciousness complex is the back office. The ego works along with the mind and the consciousness works along with the buddhi. They are the supporting officers. The ego is the ahankara, the identification as I and mine. Like, I am doing this, I am responsible for this, this is my achievement, this is my house, these are my children. Those concepts are developed and generated and rooted in the ego. The lesser the ego, the better will be the manifestation of the intellect and the consciousness. The chittam is the one which is the back office functioning along with the buddhi. Now what is its function? It is the controller of the cognition, recognition, registration, memory and recall of events. It is the intimate advisor to the buddhi, principal advisor to the buddhi. We have the manobuddhi ahankara chittas. Shankaracharya in his Nirvana Shatkam says, Mano buddhyahankara chittani naham. I am not the mind, I am not the buddhi, I am not the ahankara, I am not the chitta, but I am the superlative through them and in them. That is the chidananda rupa siyoham siyoham. He says that. Okay, let us move on to the next slide.
Atra abhimanadyaham ityahankritihi Swarthanusandhana gunena chittam.
So the internal controllers are ahamkara and chitta, mano and buddhi. The fondness about the body and its possessions and the extreme passion towards the body such as I and me is called the ahankara or ego. The consciousness or chittam is the controller of the ego and is responsible for the quick and selective registration of the perceptions as memory and the timely and appropriate recall and the erasure or forgetfulness of unwanted data. Properly developed chittam should keep the ego under absolute control and check and is the principal advisor for the buddhi. This is a summary slide which depicts mano, buddhi, ahankara and chitta. Buddhi and chitta as the higher officers, manas and the aham as the lower officers, buddhi and manas as the front office, chittam and the aham as the back office. This can be kept in the mind to recall about the dispositions and the various functions of these four internal organs. Now, let us connect this information to today's sloka in Sivananda Lahari, the 75th one.
Kalyaninam sarasa chitragatim savegam sarvengitajnyam anagham dhruvalakshanadhyam chetasturangam athiruhya chara smarare netaha samasta jagatam vrushabhadhirudha.
Let's try and understand the intricacy and the profound nature of today's slokam. Kalyaninim, the pancha kalyani, the five sensory organs, mana jnanendriyamulu, sarasa chitra gatim, the motor activities of us, the conduct of us, the five motor organs, mana karmendriyamulu, savegam, very fast in speed, the mind or the manas, sarvengi tajnyam, knowing what to be known, the intellect, the well-developed intellect or manchi buddhi, anagham, sinless, represents the ahankara, lack of ego, dhruva lakshanatyam, having all pure qualities, signifies the chittam. Anni sallakshanamulu kaliginatvanti bhagavad bhakti kaliginatvanti chittam. Such is the purity of all my equipment, O Lord, please dwell in it and tame it and use it as your horse. O Bhagavan, O Parameshwara, na manasu, na indriyalu, na buddhi, na chittam, anni kuda nike samarpinchukunnanu. Avi ati pavitranga malachukunnanu. Nivu sada na hrudayamlone, na chittamlone nivasam erparchuko swami. Ee chittanni oka gurranga chesukuni adhirohinchi chakkaga vaduko.